In this video, we are going to learn how we can evaluate and use a model on new data. We will start by training the model and saving a checkpoint of that model. Then we will load that model from the checkpoint file, pretending this is a new Python session, and evaluate it. So here we are going to reuse the CSV logger notebook from 5.6, and we are training this model so that we have something that we can save and load in a new session. So this might take a bit. I think it's 15 epochs, so we will have to wait 15 epochs until the training finished. Yeah, so after training for 15 epochs, we get our familiar plots that we have seen previously. Now we are going to save that model. Lightning should automatically save checkpoints, but just to make sure, let's explicitly save a checkpoint file. So we are calling it, let's call it model.ckpt, which is short for checkpoint, but you can name this file whatever you want. Okay, let's save it. And then in a new session, we are going to import this model and then we are going to evaluate it. So first we will start by loading the model. We will import a few utilities that we used before, and then we are going to initialize a PyTorch multilayer perceptron before we load the lightning module from that checkpoint. So here we use the checkpoint path that we defined down here in the previous notebook where we trained the model. However, notice that we are also specifying the PyTorch model here. The PyTorch model at this stage will receive new random weights, but as soon as we load the checkpoint, it will use the model weights from here for the PyTorch model. Why do we have to feed in the PyTorch model here? That's because we excluded it from the hyperparameters. So if we are looking at our lightning module here, so if we have the lightning model here, the way we defined it is we saved hyperparameters except model. That's because the model is pretty large, the PyTorch model usually, and especially if we work with multilayer neural networks that are way bigger than this one later on in this course. So we excluded the model from the hyperparameters here. We didn't save it, which is why we have to manually specify it here. And the next step is to make predictions on new data. We are going to use our data module here, but also that we have to first set up or initialize because we haven't used it here yet. So we set up our data module, and then we are saying that we are now in the test stage where we just want to use the data module without training. So now the next step is to predict on new data. So here we are going to use the test set as new data, but of course this could be any new data set. So here we are using the test set because we are also at the same time trying to evaluate our model. But again, this could be any new data set. So we are using our test set loader from the data module just to save ourselves some code. And then we are using the accuracy class from TorchMetrics for computing the accuracy. So here now we are going to iterate over the data points, over the mini batches, just like we did before, to illustrate that we can use a lightning module the same way we use a PyTorch model. So here again, this is familiar code. So we are loading the mini batches, then computing the predictions in inference mode to save memory and computation resources. We are obtaining the class labels, and then here we are using the TorchMetrics accuracy to compute the accuracy during the iterations. So let's execute this code. You can see it does indeed predict labels here. So next, let's compute the accuracy then. So we are using accuracy.compute, and then we are printing out the accuracy. So yeah, 96%, that looks reasonable. Looks like everything worked correctly. So while the project is over now for many people, because we achieved a high test accuracy, in real life, I also recommend you to look at some failure cases. So we are now inspecting a few failure cases to learn where the model does not perform so well. So let's inspect failure cases. So for that, let's define a class dictionary, just a mapping between the class labels and the string label here. And then we are going to import a function I wrote just to visualize failure cases for image datasets. So I just call this function showFailures. So yeah, if you're interested in this function, you can take a look at this looking at the shared plotting folder. So where I defined this function, but yeah, it's probably a little bit too complicated to explain in this video, a little bit too long. But if you have any questions about that, I'm more than happy to chat. Just let me know in the forum and I will be happy to explain. Okay, so this showFailureCases will then plot failure cases, things where the model made wrong predictions. So we give it the model itself, a data set, here the test data loader, and then this class dictionary, the mapping from integer label to a string label just for, let's say, legibility purposes. So let's execute this code and take a look at some failure cases. So we can see here, for example, that the predicted label P is digit 4, while the true label is a 7. But personally, I would also have a hard time here. So the true label is a 7, although it kind of looks like a 4 almost. Or considering this case here, this true digit is a 2, although yeah, it kind of looks like a 7. Or similarly here in the lower right corner, we have the true digit 6, and the model predicts a 0, and yeah, it does almost look like a 0. However, then there are other cases, for example this one, which is obviously a 9, although the model predicts an 8. Or here, the model thinks it's a 3, although it's a 9. So what we can learn from this analysis is that the model makes some really bad mistakes, for example in this case here. However, it sometimes makes mistakes because the dataset is just hard, and I bet humans would make similar mistakes. So some things we can maybe fix, while others are a little bit harder to fix. So then lastly, we will plot a confusion matrix to see for which classes the model makes the most mistakes. And yeah, for that we are going to use matplotlib for plotting, the confusion matrix class in TorchMetrix, and a little convenience function plot confusion matrix, which I wrote for my little hobby library, MLExtend. So if you have not installed MLExtend yet, you can do so by using pip, for example, executing this following command here to install MLExtend. And yeah, when I made this particular notebook, I was using MLExtend version 20. Or in particular, 0.20. So let's see what the code looks like. First, I'm initializing the confusion matrix class from TorchMetrix. So here we are having a multi-class classification problem with 10 classes. So here I'm just getting the length of the dictionary, which is equal to 10 in this case. And then like before, I'm going to iterate here over the test loader and I'm computing the confusion matrix values here. So once the iterations have finished, I will compute the final confusion matrix here and I will obtain the NumPy version, which is required by my little helper function here. Then I can use my little helper function, the plot confusion matrix function, which receives this confusion matrix as input, the class names, and then I'm also specifying that I'm going to normalize the color map, which makes it a little bit easier for a high number of correct predictions to see where the model makes mistakes. I will show you in a second what that means. The confusion matrix here. So let's run this code and see what it looks like. So the normalization function, what it will do, it will affect the color cells. So I can just show you for reference without it how it looks like. So you can see here it's a little bit harder to see where the model makes mistakes. And with this log norm, you can see better where the model makes mistakes. So you can see along the diagonal we have high values, which is good. So in this case, the model correctly predicts the digit 0 as 0 and so forth. So on the x-axis is the predicted label. On the y-axis is the true label. And we can see there are cases, for example, where the model confuses 8 and 5 often. So it thinks that the true label 8 is sometimes a 5. Or here we can see, for example, that the model often mistakes a 9 and a 3, which is something similar to what we have seen here, where the model mistakes a 9 and a 3. And yeah, here you learned about some additional techniques, how to evaluate our model beyond just the test accuracies. In this video, we learned how we can save a model checkpoint, load the model from that checkpoint, and evaluate the model.